We're so happy you can be with us. It's always a good day to praise and worship our Lord. Today is no different. But there's something special when we can all come together and do it. There's just something special about it. And we invite you to do that. If you're able to stand, please do. If you're not, just be comfortable. But let's worship the Lord today. I feel love, I feel safe, I feel Jesus in this place, I feel a warmth within me, can't describe it, but I believe, I feel
and I sing, you can call. Good morning, Vineyard family. It's so good to see all of you today and all of you watching from home. We welcome you also. If I haven't met you before, my name is Sharla, and I'm the Sunday service. What do I do? Oh, I coordinate it. Yeah, something like that. I almost said the Sunday service collector. But anyway, let's just move along. Hey, if you're a first-time guest here, we'd really appreciate it if you look in the seat back in front of you, and there's a card called a connection card. And if you'd fill that out and then drop it in one of the boxes, either by the door here or out at the welcome table, we'd appreciate it. Find out how you came to be here this Sunday. And if you do that, we'd have a welcome gift we'd like to give you that's got some cool Vineyard music in it, and we'll also donate $10 for each one to the Pontifex Food Ministry. Woo-hoo. Yes, we love partnering with them and helping to feed people in our community in Sandusky County. So thank you ahead of time for doing that. VKC and middle school students, you are now released to go to the middle doors. Miss Marsh is there. You can go to your classes while they're going. Hey, did any of you notice coming in how good the landscaping looked? And if you didn't, please check it out on your way leaving today, because we had a great team here yesterday. You know, they could have stayed home and worked in their own yards. They could have slept in, you know, whatever. But they came and they served you by helping to make this home of ours look great. And I thank them so much for that. So be sure and appreciate that. Graduates. Now, we probably have some, I'm not sure who they all are, and that's why we need you to fill out that connection card. If you have someone graduating in your family, say from high school, from college, from a trade school, whatever it might be, and they attend here, please let us know so we can set a date to honor them and their accomplishments. If you're watching from home, you can send that information to us at newhopevineyard.org. You have to do that. That's a front slash, connect. Got it? Newhopevineyard.connect. Do they got it? Thanks, Tony. Okay, then. Now, tonight we're going to have the gathering at 5:30, as usual. However, next Sunday evening, which will be May 23rd, at 6 p.m., there's this cool thing going on in Toledo. The Toledo Vineyard is hosting a pop-up worship. It's just gathering Christians from our area to get together, to worship, and to seek the Holy Spirit, ask Him to come and just fill our communities, fill our homes with the Holy Spirit, just welcoming Him in. It's going to kind of be, sounds to me, like church in the park, but church in the evening park, because it's going to be at Wallbridge Park in Toledo, which is right across from the zoo. So if you need any more information, check your announcements this week that come through the email. That'll give you more details. But so instead of the gathering next Sunday evening, we're going to try and head on up to Toledo and worship with some other believers. So before Tony comes this morning, let's just pray for our offering, our gifts, our tithes, and we don't pass the offering basket. There is a box by the back door, and there's also a box out by the information table where you can leave those today. Heavenly Father, we are just so happy to be here and to be together and have your Holy Spirit here with us. Father, bless these tithes, these offerings, these gifts that we bring back to you for everything that you've given us. And help us to be your hands and feet in this community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yeah, the is so important, isn't it? We have to affirm our volunteers here. Yes. Thank you, Sharla. You're awesome. We have a group of amazing volunteers that get here on Sundays before anyone else does, and does things, prepares things like that, and helps in the sound booth and media, and makes coffee for you guys and that. And so let's just thank them right now. We don't do it all the time, but every once in a while we have to say thank you to everybody that makes church happen, because we do appreciate you very much. One thing that was not on the announcement, because it just kind of came through at like 11 o'clock last night, and I didn't think I should probably call Charla for an announcement, because actually I was sleeping too. But I got a text from Pam Pendleton. Some of you already seen this on Facebook, but her daughters, Rebecca and Rachel, are part of a shooting team from the American Legion, and Becca was actually part of the Junior Olympics this weekend, and did really well. She set a personal best, which is pretty cool. But the young man who's on the team, Diedrich, actually got a bronze medal. And this evening will be received, the team on their way back from sometime between 5 and 7 will be receiving a police escort through Clyde and Green Springs. And heading down 19 in that. And so if you're available and you want to go welcome them back home from a really awesome Junior Olympics, that's available. Show up there and just root them on. Sometime between 5 and 7 and on 19 through Clyde and Green Springs, okay? And I'm not exactly sure the route, because it makes some turns through off of 19 and that. So just pay attention to Pam's page. If you don't know Pam, like her this afternoon. And we'll try to update the Facebook, our Facebook page, New Hope Vineyard's Facebook page, so we can get some people out there and just love on them also. Okay, so there's that. And we want to support our kids and the amazing things that they do. All right, so, all right. Well, today we're going to continue with our fifth phase of Jesus 101, Back to Basics, with Prayer 101. Today we're going to be talking about praying like Jesus. He is our teacher, our rabbi. We're the one we're supposed to emulate and become a little more like every day. And so if we're going to pray, let's learn to pray like Jesus prayed. And as disciples of Christ, we've been talking about this the last couple weeks. Prayer needs to be our default mode. We keep saying that, and I figure if we say it every week, after 4 or 5 weeks of it, it may even sink into us. Because I need to hear it. I need to hear that. Because sometimes when things go wrong, I get a little freaked out and I forget to pray. And when sometimes go great, I'm so busy celebrating, I forget to pray. And we need to remember that needs to be our fallback position at any time. We'll talk about that more as we go along. That prayer is that conversation, the two-way dialogue of speaking and listening to God. It's good, and that's what communication's about, right? Whether it's with God or with friends. We pray to do several things, and a few of them are this: to express praise, adoration, and worship, to give thanks, to tell God, I love you, to confess our sins and ask for forgiveness, to ask God to take action, whether on our behalf or our circumstances or for someone else. We ask him, Lord, come and do this. Heal this person. We pray for this person, right? And the one thing we haven't touched on yet, and I'm just going to touch on a little bit today, is praying with the right motivation and attitude, because that's essential. Because if we come to prayer as a selfish thing, like sitting on Santa's lap hoping we get what we want, that's not a very good attitude to have. And we come for several reasons. But our motivation and attitude, we're going to start with humility, because that's putting God first, you know? It's putting our needs second. It's putting the need to be seen praying. We don't need everybody to see us praying to go, wow, that's a holy person. Our holiness, our righteousness is between us and God, not everybody else. And Jesus even talked about that in Matthew 6 on the Sermon on the Mount when he said this: and when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, because they love to pray standing in synagogues and out on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Now, we do pray here also in church, a corporate prayer we call that. Prayer is a body. But we still use the humility. We don't get up in front of church and go, look at me, I'm praying holier than you are. I used more syllables in my word than you used, right? But instead we come in humility. We pray for one another. We pray for our needs. And it's between us and God. And what anyone else thinks around us is immaterial, okay? The second thing, we pray with gratitude. I'm thankful that our God, the creator of the universe, wants a personal relationship with me. We could stop right there and think about that for days, and it should create an awe within us and make us go, wow, God, the God, big G, right, wants to have a relationship with little old me. I'm thankful that Christ came and became an intercessor for me, that I can have eternal life through him. Paul writes in Ephesians 5:20, always giving thanks to God for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Always giving thanks. Even during the hard times? Yeah. Yeah, even during the hard times. We need to pray with repentance in our heart, turning our way from, turning our back toward things that are sinful, looking to God to heal us and bring confession that leads us closer to God. 2 Corinthians, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. Hear that? You hear that part? Godly sorrow, not shame, not guilt. Godly sorrow leads to salvation and leaves no regret. No shame in the Lord. Okay? We need to pray with the love of a beloved child. Man, Jesus loves you. We could say that 100 times. We sing little songs, Sunday school songs. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so, right? But do we hold it in our hearts? Even as we grow older, we're still his child. I always tell mom, when I call my mom at least once a week, because if I don't call her at least once a week, she yells at me. But I call her and I say, hey, mom, how you doing? It's your favorite son. And she says, hey, Mike, how you doing? I get my sense of humor from my mother, obviously. And then she goes down through Russ and Bill and occasionally hits my sister Pam, too, before she arrives at me. But we are our Lord's favorite child, every single one of us. I'm number one, baby. I'm the baby, but I'm still number one with mama. And we're all number one with the Lord. He loves us all the same. He will never love you more, but he'll never love you less because he's God. He just pours it all out at once. All right. We love, and we are, because of that love, we become heirs with Jesus Christ in the kingdom. Romans 8. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we also will share in his glory. Yeah, that's a tough one too, right? Share in his sufferings. Jesus never promised an easy life. He promised a fulfilled life. He didn't promise that every bad thing would go away. He just said, I'll go through it with you. And I'll never leave you or forsake you. That's being a beloved child right there, isn't it? And the other thing is, it's not about us. It's not about me. When I go to the Lord in prayer, it's not about me. As much as I want it to be sometimes, it is not about me. God is not Santa Claus that we sit on his lap. Prayer is much more than just asking for things for ourselves. Now, is it okay to ask? Yeah. We talked about that over the last couple weeks. In fact, Jesus tells us that we should ask for things. But that's not our priority. Our priority is to praise God first. We talked about that last week, remember? Praying prayers of praise. Let's just adore him and love him first and then pray for our own needs. Psalm 50:23, those who sacrifice thank offerings honor me. Your kingdom come, your will be done, we pray in the Lord's Prayer. And of course, the primary example that we talk about is the Lord's Prayer, and we'll get to that in just a second, but my notes are sticking together, and it's time to pray, so let me get that. I was told someone, I used to watch my grandma read the newspaper, and she'd do that, right? and turn the page, and I'm going, I would never do that. Never say never. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your word that just always speaks to us. It's living, it's breathing, it's life-giving. And as we explore what your word says about prayer and how it can increase our faith in you and our relationship with you, Lord, open our minds and hearts to receive it. We love you, God. We give this day to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I'm gonna continue with one warning, okay? If we wait until we feel like praying, we may never get there. If we wait until we really feel like praying, you ever been in that spot, or is it just me? Where you're like, man, I know I need to pray, but I just don't want to pray. I'm so tired. I'm so angry. I'm so hurt. I'm so frustrated. I'm so depressed. I'm so busy. Any of those ringing true to anyone else here? Because there are a lot of times I feel like that, and I go, I should be praying, but I can't bring it. And those are the times I need to be on my knees in prayer more than any other time. So we pray through, and if it feels like, man, I just feel like I'm saying the words, keep saying the words. Keep saying the words. Keep praying, and let God touch you through that. We'll talk more about that in the next few weeks, too. But a good question to ask ourselves is, am I praying with greater depth and authority than I was a year ago? What this question is really saying is, am I growing in my prayer life? Am I growing as a prayer warrior? Am I growing as an intercessor? And it's good to do those self-inventories on a regular basis and look within ourselves. Now, on a side note on that, if you're reading that and going, oh man, I don't pray enough, I'm a horrible person, and you're just filled with guilt right now, I will tell you right now, guilt is not from the Lord. Guilt is the enemy speaking to you. He's whispering to you, you're not good enough. And the end result of guilt is always to make us to feel bad about ourselves, makes us feel shameful. We just learned, right, that shame is not a thing from God. Guilt is not a good thing, nor is it from God. But when we hear those things and we feel a conviction in our heart, I'm not praying enough. I need to do something about that, right? It's a little bit different. And here's the difference. Where guilt brings shame and we know it's from the enemy, conviction is a corrective force that wakes us up to a biblical truth, to know that we can do better in Christ and with Christ. It leads us to growth and confidence in our faith journey, not shame. Confidence versus shame. Growth, not feeling bad about ourselves, okay? So there's a big difference. And the proof of a conviction is, does it cause me to grow in the Lord? Does it make me head toward him, or does it make me inward toward myself? Because that's guilt, and that's not what God's called us to. So am I praying with greater depth and authority than I was a year ago may convict our hearts. It may make us feel uncomfortable for a little bit, but it will always lead us to Christ when we do a good self-inventory. So today we're going to look at a couple biblical examples of prayer, and the first is from James chapter 5. If you have your Bibles, you can turn with us. If you're at home, please grab your Bibles, or it'll be on your screen, and at home it'll be on your screen also. We're going to do verses 13 through 15, and I'll be in the New International Version, okay? So this is not necessarily an example of prayer, but a prescription for prayer, all right? Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. Pray in every circumstances, right? Are you in trouble? Pray. Are you happy? Pray. Are you sick? Are you not feeling great? Are you having issues? Then pray and call others to pray with you. We get so ashamed sometimes of asking people for prayer. And what we need to understand is for a growing believer to pray with someone is an honor. It's a privilege. It's something we love to do. So to ask someone to pray is like opening a present for them, you know? So don't ever feel bad when you go, hey, man, I need someone to pray for me, right? And we need to be able to do that and drop our pride and come before one another and pray for each other. But that continual thing of prayer, that default position. Pray always. Here we go. And the prayer offered up in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other. Pray for each other so you may be healed. Yes, we do need to confess our sins, even to one another, if we're to be healed, if we're to be lifted up, if we're to able to grow in Christ. We need to get that funk of sin out of us. Don't carry it around with you any more than it has to. If you're thinking of something right now and you're going, man, I never did ask for forgiveness like 10 years ago. I was with some guy and I blah, 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 right? And it always nags at you. It's that thing at 3 in the morning when you wake up and you're going, man, I wonder what he's doing lately because I really wronged him. Maybe that's God saying, you need to give that person a call and go, look, you probably don't even remember me, or maybe you don't remember when this happened, but I really wronged you and I'm sorry. Would you please forgive me? That's a powerful thing, guys. That's very powerful for them and for you and for us, okay? The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. We have been talking all month about becoming more powerful and more effective in our prayer life. Well, how do we do that? By becoming righteous with holy living. If we want our prayers to be powerful, we can't just go, okay, Holy Spirit, come, empower me to pray, and then just go live like we've been living. Right? We need to say, Holy Spirit, come and empower me to live like you, to pray like you, and then to act like you, to live like you, to have that righteous life. Okay? And this whole thing is that description of what it means to have prayer as a default position. Now, when we talk about prayer, usually the first thing that comes up in people's mind is the Lord's Prayer. We talk about praying like Jesus, right? If you've been raised in a church, especially a more traditional church, you probably grew up reciting the Lord's Prayer on a regular basis. Yeah? During his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus spoke about many different spiritual disciplines, things like fasting and giving and solitude, simplicity, things like that. But he also talked about prayer. He says these are the things that we do to know our Lord better. And when he started talking about prayer, he said this, and this is out of Matthew 6, 5 through 8. He says this, he starts this way. And when you pray, let's just stop with those four words. And when you pray, he doesn't say, now if you pray, or if you have time to pray, or if it's convenient and you want to pray, he says when you pray, because he knows that as a believer, part of our everyday life should be prayer. It's as important and vital to us as eating or drinking or breathing. So he's just assuming, well, you're going to pray. So when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Remember, we just talked about this. Their reward is being seen by other people. Our reward comes from our Father in heaven. All right? We practice any spiritual discipline, whether it's prayer, fasting, study, we do it to glorify God. Now, do we receive something from it? Yeah, absolutely. Anytime we're following the Lord and giving everything to him and keeping our focus on him, we naturally get the backflow. We naturally get the blessings. We keep our focus on God, we tend to lean toward him more and live a little more righteously. It's like I did a trip with some buddies of mine out west. We hiked the Rocky Mountains in Montana. And we were out, and it was great. We spent a few days hiking in the mountains. I was scared to death. That's a whole other thing, because I do not like heights. And the idea of falling from heights is worse, and the idea of landing after that's even worse. So I did not like that part of the trip, but I loved being with my brothers in the Lord. And then from Montana, we went up to Canada, to Canadian Rockies in Banff. And we spent some time hiking up there. And one day we were driving from Banff over to Lake Louise. Beautiful part of Canada, beautiful countryside. There's mountains, there's pine trees, there's moose romping and stuff. And there was this river just filled with trout jumping. And as we're driving, our friend Tim was driving. I am getting somewhere with this. And it's just beautiful. And so we're just looking everywhere. Look, there's this over here and there's that over here. Oh, did you see that mountain over there? And I notice every time he looks, he does this with his steering wheel. Oh, look over there. And the one time as we're driving down this wonderful two-lane highway at about 65 miles per hour, there was something really cool over here. And he goes, hey, did you see that? And we didn't really notice how much he was being guided until Fred in the backseat goes, Tom! And we're in the other lane with a truck coming at us, to which we had to swerve. And all that being said is when we keep our focus on something, it tends to lead us where we need to go or where we don't need to go. So we need to be careful where we put our focus. Our focus is on Christ. And when we focus on Christ, he leads our steering wheel where we need to go. Jesus, take the wheel, right? If you got to go there, let's do it. And when you pray, do not keep babbling like pagans, for they think that they'll be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Practicing the disciplines of humility and simplicity as we pray. Knowing, guys, that sometimes few words used with much consideration and forethought can say more than pages full. You know, we'll tell God stuff in prayer. It's so funny. We'll tell him like he doesn't know. Okay, God, you know how I was going through that the other day? And God's like, I've already been through that part of the story. Just tell me, what do you need, right? You know? Sometimes we just need to go, God, I need you right now, right here. And not worry about the backstory. Other times it's good to just kind of vocalize that. Next part of this scripture, we go into what we've called the Lord's Prayer, or the Our Father in our history of the church. And we'll break it down for you now. If we're breaking it down and you're a note taker, this note is out on the resource table. Looks like this, as Lord's Prayer. Feel free to pick one up because that's part of the prayer challenge for this week, okay? This then is how you should pray, Jesus says. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Like Jesus' example, we start by first acknowledging that God is our Father, and that he and he alone is holy. Hallowed be your name. It's how we start our prayers. Our focus is on him, not on us. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Again, focusing on him. It's our statement saying, your will, your kingdom, it's about you, God. It's a plea also to say, let me take part in that. I want to be part of something bigger than me, right? Give us this day our daily bread. We ask for things that we need, not want, but we truly need. It's okay to ask for things you want too, but this is bringing every need before God, the things that are necessary to sustain ourselves, to do God's will on earth as it is in heaven. And forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. Now, some versions may say, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Or some of the more modern versions say, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. They're all the same word. They all mean the same thing. You know, it's saying, look, we are imperfect people. We are sinners. We confess that before you, God, and ask your forgiveness. And we need to forgive others too. Because later in verses 14 and 15, he says, if we don't forgive them, then our Heavenly Father can't forgive us. That's why it's important. I once heard that, you know, forgiveness always sets a prisoner free, and the prisoner is me. When I forgive someone, I'm setting myself free, not them. Think about that. And lead us not into temptation. We acknowledge our weakness, knowing that we are only able to live a holy life through his grace, but deliver us from the evil one. We know that the devil is real. Some translations just say deliver us from evil. But the word there actually in Greek means evil one. They're specifically talking about the devil. The devil is real. We're actually going to talk about that next month in our Supernatural 101 series. We're going to talk about the devil and demons and angels and all that cool stuff. But the devil is real. And he is always moving. His goal is to steal, kill, and destroy. Okay? So we're asking, deliver us from him. And then we go on and we say something, and if you've been raised in a Catholic church, you probably end the prayer right there. And if you've been raised in a Protestant church, you'll say something like this, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Right? Well, why do some churches say that and some don't? Well, it was very common practice in those days to say a doxology after a prayer. It's a short hymn-like verse used to exalt God after you've prayed to him, okay? This line first appeared in this text around 100 A.D., and it's still argued to this day among theologians and scholars, was this part of verse 13 or not? So some Bibles put it in, some will put it in italics or even parentheses, but the point is that it's in some and it's not in some, and we don't know for sure if it was in the original text. But here's the thing, it's exalting God, it's giving glory to God, it's raising God up, so is it bad to add it? This is a wonderful prayer to end. So we don't need to get hung up on those technicalities, do we? But for now, we don't say this very often in the Vineyard, do we? But today, how about if we, together, corporately, as an act of worship, would you stand with me if you're able? And if you're at home, please stand also if you're able. And if you're not able, that's cool. And we're going to say this prayer together as it's written on the screen. If you're used to trespasses or sins, you can say that, but the rest of us will pray it as it's on the screen. Ready? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. 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 Have a seat. Some people say the thine is the kingdom. Get a little more King Jamesy, right? But there's something special about it. Something special about the Lord's Prayer. When we were over in Budapest, they on the one service, they asked people to say it in their first language. And we had people in 23 different countries around the world sitting in one service. And it was really cool because everybody had the same cadence, the Our Father who art in heaven. And it was beautiful. It was like this multinational, multi-language song that just rose to heaven like incense, man. It was so cool. But it's not a magic bullet. Some churches have made this almost like a superstitious thing. Okay, if I'm in trouble, but if I say the Lord's Prayer, everything will be okay. And they just say it without meaning it, and it becomes rote. Oh, if I say it 10 times, he'll forgive this sin. Right? And it takes the words of Jesus and it turns it into some weird good luck charm that it was never meant to be. So the big question is, when it comes to the Lord's Prayer, is it prescriptive or descriptive? Because as we read the Bible in context, we need to understand that there are certain things that are said and written down that are prescriptive and others that are descriptive. And the difference is, prescriptive means that we do things exactly as they are prescribed in the Bible. They are for our direction. We are directed to do things. Go and make disciples. That wasn't just for them. That's for us, right? Bear one another's burdens. Love one another as I have loved you. These are prescriptive things. They're prescribed to us to move us into growth in Christ and to love one another, etc. So we do them as they're written. Descriptive is a little different. It means that we read things in their original context and we transpose them. They were written for someone else. And then we say, how can we apply these to our lives in some way? We don't do them exactly. And like an example is, Mark talks about Jesus getting up while it's still dark and going to pray. Well, if we looked at it as prescriptive, then all of us should have gotten up at 4 this morning and gotten up and pray. Otherwise, we're sinning. But it's not. It's descriptive. It's describing something Jesus did versus prescribing something you need to do to be a Christian, right? The Lord's Supper. We partake in the Lord's table once a month. And we have our bread and we have our juice. But we don't sit down for a full Seder dinner, do we? It's descriptive, not prescriptive. So the question is the Lord's Prayer prescriptive or descriptive? And the answer is yes. It is prescriptive in its directive to pray, daily, continually exalting God, confessing our sins, forgiving others, et cetera, et cetera. But it's descriptive in that we don't have to pray these exact words to make prayer work. This, again, isn't the magic bullet, all right? I believe that if this were, we'd see it a lot more in the New Testament, and this is the only place that we see it. Now, in Luke 11, we see a similar prayer when Jesus does what's called the Sermon on the Plain, but it is not. And you'd think if this was a prescriptive prayer that we have to say it every day exactly the way it was, then that we would be told that. But he says, pray like this, not pray this always. Either way, the Lord's Prayer is a wonderful example of simplicity, well-thought-out prayer, line after line that are powerful chunks that we say, and would that take us like 40 seconds to say that whole prayer? And yet it was powerful prayer. Let me ask the worship team and prayer team to come back up. And as they do, let's talk about prayer just as a review. We pray so that we can have open and honest dialogue with our Creator, with the Father. We pray so that our relationship with Jesus Christ will grow and flourish. We pray for things because we know God always answers prayer and never forgets a request. And we pray with the authority of Jesus Christ, confident of knowing that He always, always, always will answer prayer. He always answers prayer. And so I've got a prayer challenge like we do every week this month for this week. So this week, grab one of these Lord's Prayer if you need it and read through it. And as you read through it, as you pray through this in your own quiet time, stop after each line like we did here today a little bit and think, what does that mean to me? How can I apply that to my life today? When I say, you know, forgive me of my trespasses, what are some things I need to confess today? As I forgive those who've trespassed against me, who do I need to forgive, Lord? Right? And we go through each line and do that. So I will challenge you to do that this week. That's your prayer challenge for the week. And I'm going to ask for a prayer request for this week, too. A couple months ago, Nancy Cullen stepped down as our associate pastor so she could be an awesome bass player, I guess, because that's just rocking my face off, right? But God was doing some cool stuff in her, and we have been searching for someone as a part-time pastor to come in. And we're looking specifically, because this is the prayer I want you to pray. We want to pray specifically. We're looking for someone who will come and work with our youth, who will raise up our youth and our young people. Looking for someone who will come and add to our worship experience here and the worship experience of our 12 to 25-year-old kind of range, you know? And so would you join me, not just this week, but in weeks to come, just praying, Lord, would send the right person here to minister to our family, all right? So, Father, we just ask that right now, that you would send the right person, the right man, the right woman. You have them picked out right now, that will come and that will edify this body, that will complement this body and bring it to where you have it to be, Father God. Send someone who will minister to our youth, Lord God, our teenagers, our young adults, Lord God, as they grow not only in life, but in life with you, Father. Lord God, we just stop now and say, come, anoint that prayer. Find that person. Lead them here, Lord God. And Lord, we love you. We exalt you and we praise your name. You are worthy of our praise, and we give you all our worship, Lord God. Thank you for this day. Thank you for another day where we woke up with breath in our lungs. May we use that breath to praise you and to do good things in this world. I pray for each person in here right now, everybody who's seated, everybody up here, everybody out there, and everybody who's watching, Lord God, that you would anoint them with a new ministry, that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven, Lord God. Anoint each person here as a minister of your word that would see things, that would see people the way you see them, with grace and love and dignity and mercy. Lord God, that they would all minister, not necessarily in a church, but to the church that's around them, the people that you send to us, Lord God, on a daily basis, whether it's a person who goes to the same church or a different church or the waitress at Bob Evans, Lord God. We all need Jesus. Anoint us, Lord God. Anoint our hands and our feet that we would just serve you daily. We love you, God, and we just give this final few moments of worship to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, let's just worship.
Thank you. Holy Spirit has really been prompting me for weeks to speak on this. And today it was very forceful. And what it's about is the Pontifex. Right now, we get a barrage of mail upon who to give money to. I think the Holy Spirit is telling us that in our midst, we have the Pontifex who is feeding people, helping people in all various sources of ways. And if any of you have extra money, make sure it gets to the Pontifex. The one thing that the Holy Spirit prompted me on was the fact that you get that for 18 cents a pound, isn't that right? I don't know if you do much grocery shopping, but let me tell you something. You don't buy much for 18 cents a pound, but when you can buy chicken and beef for 18 cents a pound, they're spending your money pretty wisely. And they get their canned goods for like 18 cents a pound. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you're looking for something to give your money to help, right in this community, there's a place that needs help. And I think God is telling us, quit just looking around and do something with it, and do it in your community, and help those who really need help. Thank you. God bless that.
Okay, well, Dad talked about practical application of God's love. God's been stirring in me that he wants to impart to us an increase in sensitivity and discernment when we pray, so that we do have those deeper prayer times, that we do see God move in our midst. And what I've seen is that we'll get in certain situations and our knee jerk will go into effect instead of our prayer, because that's supposed to be our go-to. So if this is something that you want to have, that increased sensitivity and that increased discernment, I'm going to pray over us right now and have God, that you know, share that with us. Just hold your hands out in front of you so you can receive what he has for you. Father God, we want what is on your heart. We want that deeper prayer time talking with you. We ask for an increase in sensitivity of our hearts, increase of sensitivity of our spirits, that we're one with you, an increase in discernment so that we can tell when the enemy's up to no good and when you are trying to stir us. Father, we ask for those blessings, those giftings in the name of Jesus. And any place that we've become calloused, that our emotions have been knee-jerk, we give those to you. Any places that our hearts have been frozen, we ask you to thaw that. We want to have hearts of flesh that just ooze you, that are full of your love. So, Father, we receive all that you have for us right now in Jesus' name by the Holy Spirit, that we can walk out and be your lights to the people around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all,
notice somebody around you has their hand raised up like, somebody please come pray for me, go pray for them. You don't have to be a theology scholar or a, you know, ordained minister. We are all the royal priesthood in our Lord. So if you need prayer, please don't leave without it. Bless you.